Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Whatever It Takes by Gwynne Forster, narrated by Jewel Rubenstein. Chapter 1. Lacette Graham sat on the edge of her bed, wrapping a gift for her mother's birthday, though she didn't expect more than perfunctory thanks when she gave it to her later that day. The strong, cold wind, unusual for early November, rattled her windows, and she tightened her robe. But neither the temperature nor the blustery wind could take responsibility for the chill that raced through her. Familiar with her premonitions, she began to anticipate something unwanted, and her head snapped up when the door opened without a knock. It surprised her even more to see her father, the Reverend Marshall Graham, enter her bedroom. Wasn't it one of his strict rules that each family member be accorded privacy at all times? "I'm leaving your mother," he said, skipping preliminaries. "Where do you want her to meet you?" She asked him, assuming that he expected her mother to follow him. "Lisette, I'm leaving Cynthia for good." She sprang from the bed and grabbed the collar of his jacket. "What? What are you talking about? Daddy, what's going on?" The easy shrug of his shoulder didn't fool her. Her father preached the sacredness of marriage to his children and regularly from his pulpit. "If you want to know the reasons," he replied in a voice heavy with tremors, "ask your mother, but I doubt she'll tell you the truth. I'll let you know where I am." His left arm clasped her to him, and he bent and kissed her forehead. He released her, and she stared at him, speechless, trembling and a little scared, for he had just jerked the carpet of contentment and security from beneath her, stripped her of her safety net. She grabbed the foot of the wooden sleigh bed for support. "You wouldn't joke about a thing like this, would you? Today's Mama's birthday," she added, grabbing at a straw of hope. "I mean, I was wrapping her present." His eyes pitied her, kind eyes filled with a love that had nurtured her for every day of her 33 years. "I know. I also had a nice surprise for her, but, well, I'll call you in a day or so." "Did you tell Kellie?" she asked, referring to her twin sister. "She's not home, and I'm not staying here another minute. I'll call her tonight. Be in touch." Less than a minute later, she heard the front door close, walked to the window, and watched her father load three suitcases into the trunk of his gray Cadillac, a gift from the sisters and brothers of Mount Airy Hill Baptist Church. To see her father, the person in the world dearest to her, walk out of the home he cherished, with dark clouds hovering and strong winds testing his strength, sent tremors throughout her body as the tragedy of it settled into her psyche. She would remember that scene until the day she died. For a long while, she pondered what grievance her father could have against her mother, a God-fearing woman and dutiful wife. Realizing that the telephone had been ringing for some time, she got up and answered it, though with reluctance. She didn't want to talk to anyone. "Hello? Where's Marshall going? I just saw him putting three big suitcases in his car." It was her Aunt Nan, her father's only sister, who lived across the street from the parsonage, which had served as their home since her teenage years. "I don't know, Aunt Nan, but he's left Mama. That's what he told me a couple of minutes ago. I mean, he left her for good." "Girl, you go away from here. Don't let no words like that come off your tongue. It's the truth." "I can't believe it. Did he say why? No, ma'am. He told me to ask her, but he didn't think she'd tell me the truth. That don't make a bit of sense. Marshall never did believe in divorce, and he never takes a step without thinking long and hard about what he's going to do or say. Something happened that he's not telling.
Looks like it.
Well, did you ask your mother?
I want to. That is, if I get up the nerve to ask her. She's not home. Can we talk later, Aunt Nan? I'm having a problem with this.
I guess you are, child. After Lacette hung up, her first thought was what her father would tell his parishioners in church the next day, Sunday, and she made up her mind right then to be there. She moseyed around the room, fingering the little wooden statue her father called for her long before she reached adolescence, glancing toward a window at the deepening gray of the clouds, rummaging among the papers on her desk, doing nothing, aimless. A gust of wind from the front door told her that either Kellie or her mother had entered the house, and she rushed to the top of the stairs.
Kellie, Kellie, something awful has happened. Have you talked with Mama?
Haven't seen her since breakfast. What's up?
Papa left Mama. He's moved out of our home.
She couldn't believe Kellie's careless shrug. She may as well have said she didn't care.
Does it matter to you that our father has left home?
Yeah, you said so. It'll straighten itself out. Where did he go?
I don't know.
She fought back the tears, not wanting to let Kellie feel that she was the stronger of the two. Her sister already had a big enough ego.
For goodness sake, don't mope about it. How can anybody break up a 35-year marriage?
Besides, Daddy can't scramble an egg, so how's he going to get along by himself?
She hated Kellie's superior attitude. Kellie, this is serious. I don't even know where Mama is.
Don't worry about it. We'd better find a restaurant so we can take her out to dinner. What did you get her for a present?
Lacette threw up her hands, exasperated. Talking about presents when their family had just been rent apart?
Present?
Oh. I bought her a silk gown and a bottle of azure perfume. She loves that. What did you get?
Phew. Whenever I smell azure, I look around expecting to see Mama. I started smelling it before I was born. Maybe Daddy left because he got tired of it.
I bought her a red robe.
You what? But Kellie, you know Mama doesn't like red. I'm sick of seeing her in that drab green thing she wears around here. She will wear this robe.
She pointed to the shopping bag in her hand.
Because I gave it to her.
Yes, she probably will, Lacette thought, but didn't bother to articulate the sarcasm. I have to look up some information on a group of antiques. An expert on those figurines I'm hawking next week, I definitely am not, Lacette told Kellie. See you about 6:00.
Lacette worked as a freelance demonstrator of assorted household products and personal care items, but she had not previously presented valuable antiques. Anxious to open her own marketing firm, she wasn't choosy about what she demonstrated, so long as the company paid well and the merchandise was legal and decent. 6:00 came too soon, for she dreaded being with her mother and seeing her unhappy.
We're meeting her at the restaurant, Kellie explained to Lacette. She hasn't been home.
Lacette didn't like that. Her mother had always been a homebody and wasn't given to staying away from home all day, and especially not on a Saturday when parishioners would occasionally drop in.
Did you tell her about Daddy?
or do you think she knows? Of course I didn't tell her, Kellie said. It's her birthday.
You can hear this engine a mile away, Kellie said when Lacette moved her old Chevrolet away from the curb.
And it pollutes the whole neighborhood.
You're exaggerating.
Not by much. You need a new car.
New cars cost money, Kellie, and I'm trying to save to start my own business.
If you go around in this broken-down thing, nobody will go near your place when you open it. If you want to get ahead, you have to look like you already have it made. She didn't think much of Kellie's gospel. Forget the content. What mattered was the way you packaged it. However, since Kellie rarely asked for her opinion and didn't appreciate it when she got it, Lacette didn't comment. Their mother waited at a corner table at Mealy's, a cozy restaurant with low-beamed ceilings, pink tablecloths, and stone fireplaces that crackled with fire on that cool November evening. After they greeted her, it saddened Lisette to see her mother cross her arms and rub them up and down continually, as if she were cold.
Did your father say he'd be getting home late?
Kellie, who Lisette thought had both the guts and the audacity to eyeball the Pope, focused her gaze on the pink tablecloth and didn't speak.
Did you see him?
Cynthia asked, looking at Kellie, the family member who most enjoyed carrying news.
I wasn't there when he left, she said. He talked with Lisette.
Lisette hated hurting her mother, and she especially didn't want to do that on her mother's birthday. But from Cynthia's demeanor, Lisette could tell that the woman expected the hatchet to fall.
He said he was moving out of the house, and he took 3 suitcases with him. That's all I know.
A groan escaped Cynthia Graham, and she seemed to wilt, slumping in her chair and closing her eyes.
What am I going to do?
Kellie picked up her menu and began turning its pages. Keep on living, she advised. Cut your hair, shorten your skirt, slap some makeup on your face, and show him you don't give a hoot. Men suck anyway. Cynthia straightened up just a little and focused her gaze on Kellie.
Do you realize you're talking about your father?
She asked, her voice devoid of the outrage Lisette would have expected.
I realize it, Kellie replied, beckoning for the waiter. The point is, do you?
Lisette thought the meal would never end. Birthdays had always been joyous occasions that the family celebrated with fancy meals, gifts, and pranks, catering in thoughtful ways to the birthday celebrant. Without their father, who relished the occasions, their dinner had, for Lisette, a funereal air. An onlooker would have thought that they were mourning the passing of a dear one, and in some ways, they were. She pasted an expression on her face that belied the pain in her heart and hoped that neither Kellie nor her mother detected her hypocrisy. How in heaven's name could Kellie and her mother eat with such gusto? Although Kellie's plate had been piled with short ribs of beef, candied sweet potatoes, and spinach, it looked as if she had sopped it with a piece of bread, and Cynthia's looked much the same. It occurred to her, not for the first time, that in spite of their apparent differences, her mother and sister not only resembled each other physically, but had very similar personalities and behavior. By the time they reached home, Lisette had exhausted her reservoir of pretense. She gave her mother 2 packages, kissed her, and fled to her room.
Want some coffee, Mama?
Kellie asked her mother as she watched her sister hasten up the stairs.
I wouldn't mind some. Thanks. You know, I just can't figure out what got into your father.
Kellie hung their coats in the hall closet, a big one, crowded with assorted outerwear, fishing gear, umbrellas that didn't seem to belong in the neat, elegantly furnished and modernized federal house that predated the 20th century. We are not going to discuss that, Mama. Okay? Relief spread over Cynthia's demeanor, and Kellie headed for the kitchen, not waiting for her mother's reply. I hope you like it, Kellie said before she handed her mother the box that contained the red robe. You can use a change, a big change. She watched Cynthia's face as she pushed aside the tissue paper and stared down at the brilliant red fabric. She swallowed hard enough for Kellie to hear her. You gave me something. Kellie interrupted her, ignoring Cynthia's stammers, ready to drive home her point. You're still a young woman, and it's time you acted like it. 55 isn't old, Mama. When you're 80, you'll curse yourself for having wasted your youth. Cynthia stood, held the garment to her body, and walked to the hall mirror. I guess you're right. It is nice, but I was raised to believe women wore red to attract men's attention, so I... Pooh! It looks good on you. Buy yourself a red suit, or better still, a red coat. Cynthia's face bore a horrified expression that caused her daughter to wonder if her mother had been taking acting classes. When she said, Oh, Kellie, what will people think? Kellie stared at her, then shrugged. Look, Mama, if you get a decent hairstyle and a pair of shoes with a heel less than 2 inches wide to go with it, everybody will think you look great. It's time you came out of the dungeon and got with it. Cynthia gazed at herself in the mirror, letting her hand pass slowly over her right cheek before she smoothed her hair and smiled. I'm not that bad, am I? As Kellie had known, her mother would wear the red robe and enjoy it. She loved the scent of gourmet coffee, an aroma that usually gave her a sense of well-being. But at the moment, she couldn't bring herself to enjoy it. Her mind was on the frivolousness she detected in Cynthia. God forbid it was such gullibility as Cynthia had just displayed that got her into her present trouble. Kellie didn't want the coffee, but she drank it anyway, cooling it with the wind of her breath and sipping slowly, relieving herself of the necessity of talking. Sucking her teeth was the only evidence she gave of the spurt of anger that shot through her. Sure as hell, her mother didn't want to hear the words that fought to come out of her. She leaned back and closed her eyes. The time would come, though, when those unspoken words would be her trump card. She put their cups, saucers, and spoons in the dishwasher and switched off the kitchen lights. I'm going to bed, Mama. Happy number 55. See you in the morning. Thank you for making my day, honey. You going to church in the morning? Hadn't planned on it, and I probably won't. She headed toward the stairs. Good night, Mama. Good night, dear. Cynthia had it moved from her seat on the living room sofa, a lone figure in the dimly lit, almost eerie setting, with only the whistling of the wind for company. Kellie looked at her mother for a long time before going to her room, getting into her bed, and sinking into a deep, restful sleep. On that Sunday morning, Lacette arose early, cooked breakfast, and called Kellie and her mother to eat. When neither responded, she checked their rooms, found nothing untoward, and put their food in the oven. Then, as she had promised herself, she went to her father's church
and sat in her usual seat. She didn't burden her mind with thoughts of what the parishioners made of her mother's absence. Cynthia Graham did not miss Sunday morning service unless she was ill. She'd been known to attend service when she had barely enough energy to walk up the half a dozen steps leading to the front door. Lacette listened for half an hour to her father's sermon, a very good one, considering the radical change he made in his life the previous day, extolling the efficacy of loyalty and trust. She wondered if he was talking about his personal life. At the end of the service, when the people usually gathered to give praise, to share the message they received from the pastor's sermon, and sometimes to gossip about what someone was wearing and who was in what kind of trouble, Lacette dashed to the women's room and, seeing that the route was clear, rushed from there to her father's office and waited for him. Marshall Graham walked into his office and closed the door, having spent much less time with his parishioners than was usual for him on a Sunday morning. When he saw Lacette, a smile replaced his somber demeanor. She jumped to her feet and met him as he started toward her. "I'm so glad you came," he said. "I knew that if a member of my family showed up here this morning, you'd be the one. How are you?" She let herself enjoy the strength of his embrace as she tried to recall the last time she had experienced the loving warmth of her mother's arms. She kissed her father's cheek, moved away from him, and voiced the thought she'd just had. "Don't ever compare your relationship with your father to your relationship with your mother. You look to us for different things, to me for protection, and to her for social identity. When you passed your teens, your mother had to stop mothering you and let you be a woman. My role remains the same. It's the way I exercise it that has changed. So don't be hard on your mother. What's happened is between her and me, and I don't want you to take sides."
"I don't know if that's possible, Daddy. I've always felt closer to you than to anyone else."
A half smile flitted across his face. "It's enough that Kellie will take sides with her. Don't you be guilty of the same foolishness."
"I see what you mean," she said,
and she did. Kellie had always wound their mother around her little finger, avoiding guidance when she needed it and punishment when she deserved it.
"Have you found a place to stay?"
"Last night I stayed at a motel over in Newmarket, and I don't think anyone recognized me. If I let it be known that Cynthia and I are separated, the trustees might expect my family to move out of the parish house, and I don't want to see you and Kellie without a home."
She noticed that he did not include her mother in that statement.
"Let's go have lunch somewhere, Daddy. I'm hungry."
"Me too. I had a nice supper at a little inn near Lake Linganore last night. Why don't we go there? Stokey's is nice."
"You're on, Daddy. Anywhere as long as the place serves food."
"Leave your car here in my parking space," he told her. "There's no reason why we both should drive. If we go together, we'll be able to talk."
They drove along the boundary of Catoctin Mountain Park, where leaves that once hung green and heavy on the trees lay thick and beautiful in a gold, orange, and red carpet upon the ground. It was one of the reasons why Lacette loved the autumn.
"It's so peaceful along here,"
she said, glanced at the speedometer and then at her father.
"Could you please slow down, Daddy?"
He did as she asked. "I was only doing 50. "Whatever happened to that fellow, Reggie? Was that his name?"
She took his question as a sign that he wanted a change of subject.
Her father had very little tolerance for criticism, and she had just criticized his driving. Reggie neither recognized nor understood the word no, so I sent him packing. That kind of man is a nuisance. He turned off Catoctin Furnace Road into Parks Drive, a romantic lane overhung with branches that formed a mile-long arbor often referred to as Lover's Drive. He stopped in front of a white brick building that was distinguished mainly by the replica of a great elk astride its roof. Lacette made no move to get out of the car.
Daddy, I have a feeling that if we're eating here so you won't see anyone who knows us, you're going to be disappointed.
He got out, walked around the car, and opened her door. A mark of absent-mindedness, she knew, because he usually allowed her to let herself out of the car.
You think so? He asked.
Yes, sir.
He took her arm and made rapid strides to the restaurant.
We'll see.
Almost as soon as they seated themselves, the waitress arrived with two menus.
Lord Reverend Graham, it sure is an honor to wait on you.
This your daughter for sure, 'cause she looks just like you.
No, sir, you can't disown this one. She's even got that little dimple in her left cheek.
Lacette rarely saw her father flustered, but he turned the pages of the menu over and over without looking at them and drank half a glass of water, although he seldom tasted it.
Do you go to Mount Airy Hill? He asked the waitress.
I did for a while before we moved up here. What y'all having? The ribs are out of sight today, mouth-watering.
They placed their orders, and as soon as the woman left them, Marshall rested his elbows on the white tablecloth, made a pyramid of his hands, and rested his chin on the tips of his fingers.
How often do you get it right?
When I have a premonition like I did earlier, I know to expect something, but I never know what.
Like tomorrow, she thought,
but didn't say, for whatever came would not be welcome. She fingered the little medallion in her purse and prayed for the best. After lunch, he drove her back to the church.
I hope you and Kellie took your mother out to dinner for her birthday last night.
He parked the Cadillac beside her old Chevrolet.
The Bible tells us, honor thy father and thy mother. And I've tried to instill that in you and your sister. She's your mother, no matter what.
Was he preparing her for something, or did he have a guilty conscience? Somehow, she didn't think he was the one nursing guilt.
We took her to Mealy's, and it was as gloomy an occasion as I have ever witnessed. I thought it would go on forever. I didn't even enjoy the crab cakes, and that should give you an idea of how miserable an affair it was.
I can imagine. And I'm sorry, but I'd have been a liar if I'd had dinner with her. I'm going to run by and see Mama Carrie for a couple of minutes. Then I'm going back to the motel till time for evening prayer.
He wrote his telephone number on the back of his business card and handed it to her.
Call me if you need me, he said, got into his car, and headed to his mother-in-law's house.
As she drove home, it occurred to her that she should look for a place of her own. Her father had discouraged her attempts to move out of his house, claiming that nice girls stayed home until they married, but he was no longer their family anchor. Besides, she remained with the family because he would consider it an affront if his unmarried daughters lived alone in a town in which he resided, although he would have accepted their moving to another locality. Male pride was a thing she didn't think she would ever understand. The next morning, Lacette awoke suddenly and sat up in bed, startled by the banging on her door. Seconds later, Kellie rushed into the room.
Ginga just called. She found Grandma unconscious, and the ambulance is taking her to Frederick Memorial.
Lacette slid off the bed and struggled into her robe.
I'd better call Daddy. He went to see her yesterday afternoon. Where's Mama?
Getting dressed. You talked with Daddy yesterday? Oh, that's right. You went to church.
Lacette telephoned her father and gave him the news. How was she yesterday?
She looked great. When I got there, she was watching the Ravens on television. We had a good visit, and I promised to see her next Sunday. I'll get over to the hospital to see how she's doing.
An hour later, he approached his mother-in-law's hospital room as Lacette, Kellie, and Cynthia emerged from it.
What's the matter? He asked, rushing forward, his face ashen.
Is she?
She's gone,
Lacette said.
She had an embolism. Nothing could be done. He gasped.
Then, in a quick recovery, he took her mother's hand.
I'm terribly sorry, Cynthia. Mama Carrie was a mother to me for more than 35 years. When I left her yesterday, her spirits were high, and she was in a good mood, happy. I'm thankful for that.
He parked behind Lisette's car when they reached home, went in with them, surprising Lisette, and sat with them in the living room of what, until the previous morning, had been his home. She gazed at the people around her, sitting together in total quiet as if they were still a family. Unable to bear it, she rushed from the room, explaining that she would make coffee. After forcing herself to settle down, she made the coffee, for she knew Kellie wouldn't do it. She let enough time pass for the chill to lift from the living room, put the coffee pot, four mugs, sugar, and a half pint of milk on a tray, and took it to her family.
I know it isn't easy for you, Cynthia, her father was saying when she walked back into the living room, but we have to talk about the service. It's best to have it Saturday morning, and the interment directly from the church that afternoon. I'll have my secretary take care of bulletins, media announcements, ushers, and so on, and she'll email all of the parishioners who are online. One of you girls write out a short page on Mama Carrie's life and email it to Mrs. Watson. He looked at his estranged wife as if gauging her attitude.
You want to go with me to the funeral home to pick out the casket, or do you want to leave that to me?
She wiped her eyes.
You're doing all this after what?
He cut her off. This isn't about you, Cynthia. I'm doing it for Mama Carrie and for my daughters.
Lacette sucked in her breath and stared first at her mother and then at her father, looking for a clue, anything that would tell her what had gone wrong between them. But the most experienced actors couldn't have covered their feelings more adeptly.
Well,
for whatever reason you're doing it, Cynthia said, I certainly do thank you. And I'd rather not go pick out the casket.
Lord, I can't even believe she's gone.
She covered her eyes with a handkerchief, but only for a second.
Don't worry, Marshall, she said, sitting up straighter in the chair and crossing her knees. I'm not going to break down, at least not now. Without another word, she left them and went up the stairs to the room she once shared with her husband.
10 days later, Kellie sat in a lawyer's office along with Lacette, her parents, and Ginga, her mother's friend and cleaning woman, to hear the reading of Carrie Hooper's will. To her mind, only Lacette, their mother, and she should be there, because they were her grandmother's descendants and rightful heirs. Instead of dividing what was left by three, it would be shared by five people. She didn't really object to her father having any of it. But why should he? 18 years earlier, Carrie Hooper would not have had a will. She was poor, a $30-a-week cook in Rosewell, North Carolina, a widow who depended on the $150 that her son-in-law sent her every month. After a fire burned her wood frame house beyond repair, Marshall, her son-in-law, brought her to Baltimore where she became a member of his family. Her love for Marshall was obvious to anyone who cared to observe it. Cynthia complained that her mother only cooked foods Marshall liked and favored him over her in many ways. Carrie would reply, "You should be half the daughter to me that he is a son to me. You're too self-centered." No one would have believed that Carrie played the lottery until she hit it for a little more than $1 million. Everyone who knew her and who heard about it wanted some of it. But Carrie announced that she would give 10% to the Lord's work, finance her granddaughter's college educations should they decide to go, and repay Marshall the $30,000 he'd sent her in monthly subsidies over the years. Within a week after Carrie hit the lottery, Marshall received the call to pastor the Mount Airy Hill Baptist Church in Frederick, Maryland, and moved his family into the church's parsonage. Carrie bought a Victorian-style house, furnished it, and lived comfortably about a mile from the parsonage. She often boasted that her son-in-law didn't let a week pass without dropping by to see her, and complained that she received a visit from her own daughter about once a month, twice if she was fortunate. Rocking in her Brentwood rocker, she would almost always add, "Cynthia's gonna regret her ways, but unfortunately, I won't be around to see it." "This is straightforward," the lawyer said as soon as he sat down. "You're all here. Now, let's get started." He read the will. "To my daughter, Cynthia, I leave my car, my fur coat, and any of my clothing that she wants. To my granddaughter, Kellie, I leave my diamond ring and what money remains in my account at Frederick County Bank. To my granddaughter, Lacette, I leave my diamond brooch." He paused at Kellie's loud gasp. "And all the money in my account at First United Bank and Trust, except $25,000, which I leave to my friend, Ginga Moore. To my son-in-law, Marshall Graham, I leave my house and all of its contents, except my clothing." He passed a copy of the will to each of them. "That's it, except my condolences and my best wishes." "I don't believe this," Kellie said. "She knew how I love that brooch. I told her 100 times that I wanted it, and she gave it to Lacette." "Come on, let's go," Cynthia said. "I've had enough for one day. I'll bet that account she left me doesn't have as much in it as the one she gave to Lacette." "At least she left you some money," Cynthia said. "How do you think I feel, knowing she cared more for my husband than she did for me?" Kellie rolled her eyes. "Spare me, Mama." She glanced around, hoping to cast an accusing look at her father, but was deprived even of that small pleasure, for at that moment he and Lacette walked out of the office.
She'll get that brooch over my dead body. Kellie muttered. Don't you care that she left that house to Daddy? It must be worth $200,000 or $300,000.
Cynthia pulled out of Kellie's grasp and walked ahead of her.
I don't want to talk about that right now. I'm still dealing with the fact that she's dead.
But they're getting everything. Leave me alone, Kellie.
Kellie leaned against a chair, gaping at her mother's departing back. On an impulse, she crossed the room to where the lawyer spoke on the telephone and waited.
Do you have the ring and brooch? She asked him after he hung up.
I'll have them tomorrow. Be here around 10.
Thank you so much,
she said, softening her demeanor.
It hurts, like somebody stabbed me. She was my favorite relative, and I loved her more than I loved my parents or my sister. It was so sudden.
She let her left hand graze his forearm.
Grandma was a wonderful person.
He believed her. He had to believe her because she meant to have that brooch, and he was going to help her get it. Kellie knocked on attorney Lawrence Bradley's office door at 10 the next morning and, in response to his greeting, pushed the door open and walked straight to his desk. She hoped her gray suit and white blouse with a Peter Pan collar made her appearance suitably prim and ladylike. She extended her hand.
Thank you for being so kind, Mr. Bradley. I'm still reeling from the shock of my grandma's death.
I can imagine. Have a seat.
She sucked in her breath and nearly sprang from her seat at the sight of the 2-carat, pear-shaped diamond ring banked by 4 sizable diamond baguettes.
It's beautiful, he said, and very expensive. She insured it for $10,000. Sign here, please.
He smiled, and she thought on his expression wistful. Although her mind was on Lawrence Bradley, she managed to sign the receipt and resist the urge to grab the ring. He handed it to her, and she slipped it onto the 3rd finger of her right hand. When Bradley returned her smile, she decided to test the water. What could she lose?
I'll take the brooch to Lacette, if you like, she said.
He leaned back in his chair and looked at her until she felt herself shrinking by the seconds, for he wasn't cataloging her feminine assets, but judging her.
Sorry, he said after letting her squirm for a couple of minutes.
The brooch wasn't in Mrs. Hooper's effects. I'll have to search for it.
She forced a smile. Maybe he was toying with her and maybe he wasn't, so she had to bide her time.
What a pity. My sister will be anxious about it.
If his shrug was meant to disarm her, it was wide of the mark. This time she didn't smile. With his gaze boring into her, he said,
Somehow I doubt that. She didn't seem the type to get bent out of shape over a piece of jewelry, or much else, for that matter. I'll call her.
Make it subtle, girl. This one's no pushover.
You're kind. You know, Lacette and I don't look alike, but we're twins.
She made the comment as a switch from business to personal topics in hope of getting on intimate terms with him.
I know. Your grandmother told me.
Carefully and deliberately, she pushed back the left sleeve of her jacket and the cuff of her blouse and looked at her watch.
I've kept you too long, and I have to get over to Walkersville by noon, or I would be very brazen and ask you to have lunch with me. He pierced her with a steady gaze, and she couldn't read him.
"Yes," he said at last. "Another time."
He walked with her to the door, and she extended her hand. When he took it, she clasped his tightly and looked him in the eye.
"I hope to see you again. Soon."
She turned and walked out without giving him a chance to answer her. Her instincts told her she was ahead, and she meant to stay that way. After leaving the lawyer's office, Marshall drove Lacette home, parked, and stepped across the street for a visit with his sister, Nan. Maybe she could help him deal with the shock of inheriting one of the most attractive properties in that part of Frederick. Some would say that it rightfully belonged to Cynthia, but he knew how Mama Carrie felt about him and didn't doubt that she had a reason for distributing her property as she had.
"I'm trying to figure out why Mama Carrie left me her house and everything in it except her clothing," he said to Nan after telling her about the will.
"Nan, that house has to be the bulk of her estate. My lord, she practically ignored Cynthia. A 400-year-old Mercedes and an even older mink coat. I don't understand it." Nan stood and braced her hands against her hips. "Come on in the kitchen with me. I'll fix us some lunch. Won't take but a minute."
"What do you think?"
He sat on a stool beside the kitchen window and parted the yellow curtain to get a clear view of the world outside.
"Shouldn't Cynthia have been angry or upset the way Kellie was about Lacette getting the brooch?"
Nan wiped her hands on the apron she wore and leaned against the kitchen counter. "Cynthia is loaded with guilt. Besides, I suspect Miss Carrie told her she was getting practically nothing. She let her poor old mama slave in those white folks' kitchens for peanuts down there in Rosewell and didn't send the woman 5 cents. She rolled her eyes toward the ceiling. "And she did that even when she was teaching and making money. A perfectly good mink coat and that nice car are a lot more than she deserved."
Nan could be right, but her answer didn't satisfy him. He thought for a while. "When I'm ready to take over that house, Cynthia will have to find a place to live. The deacons won't let her stay in the parsonage after they learn that we've separated. Kellie and Lacette are grown, and they need to be on their own, away from their mama's petticoats, and especially Kellie. If she doesn't change, she's going to have a hard life."
Nan flipped over a mushroom omelet and stuck her left thumb in her mouth to ease the effect of the hot grease that splattered on it.
"Tell me about it. You leaving Cynthia for good?"
With his hands cupping his knees and his feet square on the floor, he stared at her.
"When did you know me to take a step this serious and then back up and say I made a mistake?
Believe me, it's over." "I sure would like to know what happened to make you take such a hard position. You always acted like that woman was the apple of your eye, and she acted like she knew she was."
"Ask Cynthia. She's got the whole story."
Nan put the omelets, several pieces of toast, and slices of ripe avocado on their plates and set the food on the kitchen table.
"Milk or tea? I'm having tea." "You know, Marshall, Miss Carrie was a good Christian woman, but, well, you think she did the right thing?"
"Lord, we thank you for this food and for each other. Amen."
He put a sliver of omelet in his mouth and savored it.
Very good indeed. I'll get some milk."
He went to the refrigerator, poured a glass of milk, and went back to the table. Nan, Mama Carrie was shrewd, so I'm not questioning what she did. I expect we'll eventually have all the answers. And I don't doubt that what we find out will set tongues wagging like an electronic clapper. Nan sipped her tea slowly, a sip now and then as if she didn't know she was doing it. You know, I never was crazy about Cynthia. She gave the impression that she served all who needed her, but her main concern is and always has been herself. She was a dutiful housewife, and she was always good to your parishioners. She kept up a good front, all right. But when you went a little deeper, there wasn't a thing there. She don't do nothing for nobody lest something's coming her way. Still, I feel sorry for her. Miss High and Mighty is about to bite the dust, and if you don't stop Kellie right now, she'll be right down there in the dust with her mother. He heaved a sigh and shook his head, as would one perplexed. I know Kellie has some bad habits. She wants everything Lacette has, and when Lacette gives it to her, she throws it aside or destroys it. She's been that way since they began to crawl. As soon as she'd see Lisette's toys, she would throw hers away and demand Lisette's identical one until Lisette gave it to her. Nan rolled her eyes. It's not just things. Don't you remember when she stole Lisette's high school prom date and Lisette couldn't go to her senior prom? He put their dishes in the dishwasher and padded his pockets for his car key. I punished Kellie for that, but it did no good. She was 18 then, and 15 years later, she's going to die trying to get that brooch from Lisette. Thanks for lunch. He wrote something on a card and handed it to her. You can reach me at this number. He ambled across the street, got into his car, and headed for the funeral home to make arrangements for the woman who had mothered him as his own hadn't had an opportunity to do. Kellie's antics troubled him. She had refused her grandmother's offer to send her to college and didn't attend. But she resented the fact that Lisette had a university degree and that Mama Carrie financed it. She would be determined to get Lisette's brooch, and he'd be just as determined to prevent her from having it. Chapter 2 Lisette raced to the phone, hoping that the caller was the buyer for Beauty Serums, Inc., which had engaged her to demonstrate its products at a fair in Baltimore's Lord Calvert Hotel. She prospered financially through her work as a product demonstrator, but concentrated on her goal to have her own marketing firm. She hadn't worked for a degree in marketing, just to stand at a table and praise the work of whoever invented the product she demonstrated. Hello, Lisette speaking. Miss Graham, this is Lawrence Bradley. The brooch your grandmother left you was not in the effects that she stored with me. It's possible that it may be in her house, so I suggest we get your father's permission to search for it. However, neither you nor I can do that until he takes formal possession of the place. I'm afraid you'll have to wait. Thanks, Mr. Bradley. I'm not worried about it. As soon as Kellie sees it, she'll want it and she'll plague me about it until I give it to her. Really? She got an exquisite diamond ring that ought to satisfy her. The bitterness of her laugh embarrassed her, and she tried to eradicate its effect with the softening of her voice. You don't know, Kellie. I'm getting an idea. I'd appreciate it if you'd go with me to the bank. You'll remember that Ginga Moore's $25,000 is in the account Mrs. Hooper willed to you. She needs the money. We can go today, if you'd like. Suppose we meet there at 1. I'll pick you up at your house around 12:30, if you don't mind. Thanks. I'll be ready.
She spent the remainder of the morning telephoning prospective employers and received 3 offers to demonstrate products. She turned down an offer to pitch condoms to women at a conference on childcare, and another one to stand in the window of a department store demonstrating brassieres. She had a nice top and was proud of it, but wouldn't consider using it for an advertisement. She dressed in a royal blue suit and her standby, a street-length camel hair tuxedo coat, and waited in the living room for Bradley's arrival. The man rang the doorbell promptly at 12:30, and as if Kellie had overheard their conversation, and she had not, she arrived home as Bradley opened the front passenger's door of his car for Lacette. Kellie stopped, gaped at them with widened eyes, and quickly regained her composure. Self-assurance was Kellie's trademark, and Lacette stared in disbelief when her sister walked to within a foot of the man and grasped his arm. "I'm sorry I wasn't home. I had to do something to take my mind off my grandma's death, so I've gone back to work." "Nice seeing you," Bradley said, walked around the car, got in, and drove off. So Kellie was after Bradley. "I shouldn't get personal," Lacette said, "but I can't help wondering how your family deals with your irregular hours. Mama said she was in your office Sunday afternoon." "Not all of my work involves distributing inheritances, thank God. You'd be surprised at how well grief and greed get along. My family understands this part of my job." She wondered if Kellie knew he was married and whether, if she did know it, she would back off. Probably not. A bank official deposited $25,000 in an account for Ginga Moore and transferred the remainder of the money in Carrie Hooper's account, $189,000, to a new account for Lacette.
"I had no idea Grandma was leaving me this much, Mr. Bradley. I'm stunned."
"Keep it to yourself, unless you want to share it."
"Why did she leave Mama so little?"
"She said she had good reasons, and that your mother knew what those reasons were. If I were you, I'd leave it alone." To Lacette's surprise, Kellie was still at home when she got back there. One look at her sister, and she saw the threat of war as clearly as if Kellie had handed her a document declaring it. "What the hell was he doing here with you? You want everything, don't you, Lacette?" "Well, you're not getting it. How much is in the account Grandma left you?"
"How much is in yours?"
"I have to get back to the office. I'm already late." "You stay away from Lawrence Bradley." She was about to assure Kellie that the man didn't appeal to her and that, in any case, she didn't get involved with married men, but stopped short when she saw the anger in her sister's eyes. Instead, she said, "If you know what's good for you, you'll stay away from him." Kellie misunderstood that as a threat, but left without pressing the issue. Their grandmother's death seemed to have brought out the worst in Kellie, mean, cunning, and devoid of her usual humor and wit.
"I'm getting out of here as soon as I can find a house."
Kellie slipped into the office minutes before her supervisor returned from lunch. "You just made it," Mabel, a secretary who sat across the corridor from her, said. "And it's a good thing, because she's been on the warpath all morning. I'd have covered for you if you hadn't made it back."
"Thanks, girl. You're a good buddy. Say, did you see that guy pruning trees out there? I think that's what he was doing. What's a hunk like that one doing risking his cute little butt up in a tree? He ought to have Mr. Walker's job."
"Yeah,
You let Walker hear you say that, and you'll be up a tree.
Laughter poured out of Mabel. Kellie thought her co-worker enjoyed her own jokes more than anyone else did.
What's the name of that fellow who's working on those trees? She asked Mabel.
Now you leave the guy alone. Thank God it's too cold for you to swish around out there with your tits hanging out and your skirt up to your ass.
Kellie grinned.
Shoot, girl. If you got it, flaunt it, is what I say. Anyhow, I don't show them a thing they don't enjoy looking at, but I don't waste my assets on Tom, Dick, and Harry.
Don't hand me that, Mabel said. If you want something out of them, you'll offer up your booty as fast as a bondsman will put up bail.
I'm on to you, girl. You dress like Miss Anne and talk like a lady, but you got grit in your teeth.
Kellie let a smile float over her face to give the impression that she thought Mabel was joking, but she knew the truth in the woman's comment.
Come on, Mabel. Just because I'm proud that I have it doesn't mean I let just anybody use it.
I ain't the priest, so don't be confessing to me. It's yours. You do what you please with it.
You forget I'm a minister's daughter. I was properly brought up.
Yeah, I gotta get my work done.
Kellie didn't like being put down by a woman she considered beneath her, but she wanted a promotion from secretary to receptionist, which to her mind was a more prestigious job, and she stood a better chance if her colleagues liked her.
Good idea, Mabel. I want to finish this report so I can leave a little early.
She completed it, put it on the supervisor's desk, and headed outside for another look at the man she saw in the tree earlier that afternoon. As she approached, he climbed down from the ladder.
Don't you get dizzy up there?
She asked him.
I would. What were you doing to the poor tree anyway?
I was inspecting it for disease. He collected his tools and the ladder, tipped his baseball cap, and headed toward the building's basement entry. Angry with him for ignoring her and furious with herself for speaking to him, she promised herself that she'd make him pay.
Men make me sick,
she said aloud, repeating a sentiment she'd uttered to her mother when her father left home. She wondered if she believed it, and wasn't so sure when she recalled her first sexual experience at the age of 14. The man was her father's close friend and a deacon in his church. Suddenly she began to giggle. That man had been crazy about her. He'd keep his head between her legs as often and as long as she'd let him, and all she had to do was caress him and stroke him. He'd be talking with her father in Marshall's office at home, and she'd go in and make up a yarn to tell her father while she rubbed and pinched her breasts as she stood behind her father's chair, toying with the man. Before he left the house, he would manage to get her in the basement and do all kinds of things to her while her unsuspecting father worked on his Sunday sermons. She hadn't let the man penetrate her and often wished she had. He heated her up, and no other man had been able to do it. She considered stopping by Lawrence Bradley's office and thought better of it. Desperate to get the brooch before Bradley delivered it to her sister, she stopped by Benny's Jerked Chicken, a shop less than a block from Bradley's office, and telephoned him.
Bradley.
Hello, Mr. Bradley. This is Kellie Graham. Do you mind if I call you Lawrence?
No, I don't, but I can't see that it's necessary.
Oh, please, not you two. This has been one awful day. From the time I rolled out of my bed until a few seconds ago,
It's been downhill. His pause lasted too long for her comfort. At last he said, "What happened a few seconds ago?" Just the lead she wanted.
"I heard your voice."
"Oh, come on, Miss Graham. You can do better than that."
"I wish I could, but from the minute I heard your voice."
She paused. Let him think about that. "I'm not far from you. How about coffee or something?" Her heartbeat thundered in her chest while she waited out his silence.
"I'd like to know what you want," he said,
but the gruffness in his voice only encouraged her. Emboldened, she could feel the smile crawling over her face. He might be a big-shot lawyer, but he was a man, wasn't he?
"You're a grown man. You know the answer to that."
Again, he let her wait.
"Where are you?"
This time, it was she who let time pass.
"I'm at Benny's Jerk Chicken."
"That's half a block away. Come up here."
Well,
she pretended to consider his suggestion. Then, as if he initiated the idea of their meeting, she said,
"I don't know if I should."
All right, but just for a few minutes. Suddenly, she remembered that she was wearing a red cowl neck sweater under that charcoal gray coat, and that he may think her period of mourning for her grandmother strangely short. She shrugged.
"I won't give him a chance to think about that."
After repairing her makeup and combing her hair in the women's room, she set out for her tryst with Lawrence Bradley, her steps quick and sure-footed. Leaving the sixth-floor elevator for the short walk to his office, she refreshed her perfume, put the flask back in her pocketbook, and knocked on Bradley's office door. He opened the door at once, took her hand, and pulled her into his office. She hadn't expected to find him without his jacket and tie, and told him as much.
"I work comfortably whenever I can. Why did you want to see me?"
She lowered her lashes, pulled off her gloves, and placed them and her pocketbook on his desk.
"Try being more subtle, Lawrence. That works better with me."
He walked to where she stood and pulled her to him, so close that her breasts felt the pressure of his pectorals against them.
"This works for me," he said, and bent to kiss her,
but she moved her face and stepped away from him.
"What's your game, Kellie?"
She let a half smile crawl over her face and bathed her lips with her tongue.
"I don't like being pawed."
Both of his eyebrows shot up.
"I stand corrected. Care for a glass of white wine? Or something stronger?"
"Wine, please."
She removed her coat, sat on the sofa that rested in the far end of the office beneath a window, and crossed her knees. He returned with the wine, handed her a glass, and sat beside her.
"Let's get this straight. I am not going to let you toy with me. Understand? He is to a beautiful, reckless woman."
He drained his glass. Kellie had the feeling that Lawrence Bradley might be more than she could handle. She sipped the wine and pretended that he wasn't gazing at her. Then she put the glass on the table beside her and stretched both arms out on the back of the sofa. His hands were hard and firm on her, and his grip told her he meant business. He gripped her beneath her knees and swung her legs across his lap. Then he maneuvered her until she was lying on the sofa, flat on her back. She looked up at him, dazed as he unbuttoned his shirt. It hung open, baring his chest, and he reached down and eased her sweater over her head. "Are you going to stop me?" he asked her. The question came too late. She had forgotten her scheme, and her only thought was of the man leaning over her, big and strong, both threatening and promising in his masculinity. An unfamiliar urge to explode with him buried inside surged through her, and she didn't answer, merely unhooked her bra and offered him her breasts. He worked her over like a scientist in a chemistry laboratory, methodical and thorough, until he spent himself. At least he enjoyed it, she thought. He didn't want for skill. Indeed, he was probably an expert. The problem was that she didn't feel anything, and it had nothing to do with him, for it always happened that way. "Come back tomorrow, about this time," he said. "I could get used to you, and the more we're together, the more perfect it will be." Knowing that she pleased him was all that was needed to put her back in her element. He could get lots of women, but he wanted an affair with her. She went into his bathroom, washed up, and dressed. He hadn't given her an orgasm, but he was damned sure going to get that brooch for her. "Tomorrow," she asked him, when she walked back into his office, "you've got a big appetite." "For you, yes. I want you here tomorrow." "Sorry," she said. "It'll have to be day after tomorrow." He stared at her until she thought he could hear her nerves rattling. "All right, then. Day after tomorrow." Lacette wondered at her sister's coldness at dinner that evening. Their mother tried to make conversation, but having lost touch with both her daughters, her efforts fell flat. "What were you doing in here this morning with Lawrence Bradley?" Kellie asked Lacette for the second time.
"Was Mr. Bradley here?" Cynthia asked. "He could at least have brought my fur coat."
"Are you going to drive Grandma's car, Mama?"
Lacette asked, hoping to divert Kellie's attention from the matter of Lawrence Bradley's presence in their home.
"Yes, if I ever get my hands on the keys. Who wouldn't drive a Mercedes? With your daddy gone, I'll need it."
"I went down to the Board of Education this morning to see if I could get my old teaching job back. I'll substitute for the remainder of the school year, and next term I'll teach full-time, 7th grade as usual."
"Mama, that's wonderful,"
Lacette said. She hadn't thought her mother would adapt to the breakup of her marriage with such seeming ease.
"You're right to get on with your life."
"She doesn't have a choice," Kellie said.
"So that's where you were this morning when Lacette was here making out with Bradley. How cheap can you get? You only met the man a little over a week ago, for heaven's sake." Astonished at Kellie's accusation, she opened her mouth to deny it and changed her mind. If Kellie thought Lacette wanted the man, she would probably make a fool of herself over him. Her instinct had always guided her to yield to her twin sister, catering to her at the expense of her own interests and needs. Submissiveness welled up from someplace within her, and she fought to quell it, to remember her father's admonition that she stand up for herself. Without saying a word in her defense, she took the dishes to the kitchen, rinsed them, and put them in the dishwasher, went back to the dining room, and sat down.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.